Welcome, everyone. This is the premiere episode of the High Stakes Podcast with Adam Ace. We are coming to you from a car on the road late at night. It's now 9 p.m. We're coming back from the Torture Chamber Pro Wrestling Dojo. My first ever guest on the podcast, Mustapha Jordan, also known as Mustapha Jordan Richardson. He is one half of the Canadian Tag Team Champions with the Night Train Express. Stefan Paulson is his tag team partner. Mustapha, how you doing?
Unbelievable, unbreakable, unstoppable. Always on and never off. Simply put, on another level. More than another level, I'm talking saves. Beyond the ionosphere, to the metals and exosphere, to the astronomers and astrologers out there, these words go together better than bread and butter, cops and robbers, grease on chicken. You better find a jolly lady and make her sing, because these words are Mustapha Jordan Richardson, your next world champion. Just like that. If you have any reservations about this, I suggest you go to Steve's music store and learn to blow a flute. To do that, I salute. That's how I'm doing. And you, sir?
Damn, that was a mouthful. I'm doing good, but I feel bad because all I'm saying is I'm doing good and you had that whole spiel.
Is that you have to be better than good and better than most. So with that in mind, you come up with three things, the power of three, right? So unbelievable, unbreakable, and unstoppable. Which has the most power? Unstoppable. Unbelievable. It's like, you can't believe how good I'm feeling. Unbreakable, you can't break my spirit. Unstoppable, you can't stop me. And that's where that came from. That's where that comes from, you know. So with that in mind, that whole spiel was created a few years ago. About the short version of it, just I'm unstoppable. If I want to get into a whole thing there, you know. But sometimes I asked my dad. My dad is like, hey, I'm magnificent, this and that. And I started out with him, and he started working out with me. Whenever I call back home.
That's amazing, dude.
Yeah, man. It's
seems like your dad was a good inspiration on you.
Yeah, he is. You know, he taught me how to do things and how not to do things. So
yeah.
In the same light, you learn a lot, you know, and it's very important that all the lessons that you learn in life, that you apply them, good or bad, they're all meant to teach you something.
That is true. That is very, very true. You always got a lesson to learn, no matter what it is that you're doing.
Yep.
Whether you succeed or whether you fail, you're going to learn a lesson from it if you're doing it right.
Yeah, it's like in wrestling or in speaking. I can speak on both because outside of wrestling, I'm a youth motivational speaker, or known as a public speaker.
Okay.
Now, my demographic is youth, but my niche or specialty or specific niche I speak to is youth ages 4 to 19, or even a little bit older than that. So they have a certain way of understanding that I have to meet them where they at and not try to get into where I am. So this comes from me being a former basketball coach for that demographic. And when I was there, I was I had the duty to more than teach them about basketball, but teach them about life. So the vehicle I used was the sport. And understanding the sport and using the sport as an analogy to life helped a lot of them grasp it a lot faster.
Okay.
Depending on the level that they were. So I'll say, for example, the ball represents an opportunity. And if you're not willing to pass the opportunity for it to come back to you, why would anyone want to give it to you in the first place?
Okay, I like that.
So with that in mind, and other drills and certain stuff, I try to give them motivation through the medium of basketball. Because I can raw millions of X's and O's based on my level of understanding the game, but it doesn't mean anything. It doesn't have a meaning behind it.
I like that. No. I like that a lot. And you mentioned earlier on, you're also a wrestler. And
yes,
this is a wrestling podcast primarily, but we do talk about other things.
Yeah.
Now, me and you, we have gone toe-to-toe a couple of times.
Yes, we have, and they've been quite interesting. Every time we get in the ring, we tell a very interesting, beautiful story. You can even say it's like a whimsical recollection of super kicks and uppercuts.
But yeah. I like that. Now, I know at some point there's going to be some sort of a smart mark who's going to listen to this podcast and saying, oh, well, you two fought each other. Why are you two doing a podcast? Okay. Let me break this down for you, okay? Me and Mustapha, we're friends. We have similar upbringings.
Yep.
We have similar paths, similar goals. We are friends, first and foremost. We are also professional wrestlers. Let's key that word in again. Professional wrestlers. Which means, when that bell rings, it's now me versus you.
Yeah.
And I want that win. You want that win.
Yeah, because it's... You need to understand... People need to understand that it's money on the table.
That's it.
If you lose, you get less money. If you win, you get more money. Or you get more opportunities, which will lead to more money. Understanding that and understanding any form of combat sports and entertainment, that includes boxing, that includes mixed martial arts, it's about how you win or how you lose that will enable you to put more food on your table. Prime example, in one of these facets, let's use mixed martial arts for example. Is Conor McGregor the best? That is debatable. But whether he wins or he loses, he puts money on the table or he brings money to the table. Mayweather or Deontay Wilder or Anthony Joshua, or I forgot the current gentleman who defeated Joshua for the three belts.
Yeah.
Anthony Ruiz, pardon me, and can correct me if I'm wrong. I'm not sure how you pronounce his name, but these gentlemen put money on the table, and everyone who's on that card gets a bigger cut of the pie. Now, fast forward to wrestling, people complain about this so-and-so's in the main event, or so-and-so's on this card, or so-and-so doesn't wrestle. The question you need to understand, if that person is not there, do they draw the same amount of attention? Do they draw the same amount of notoriety? Do they draw the same amount of money? It's all about drawing. It's even like the same in movies.
Yeah, definitely.
That's why movie actors are paid more than TV show actors. Movie actors are going to motivate you to leave your home. The comfort of your home, your couch, your bed, whatever you use to be comfort in, to go and sit in a theater for 2 hours or whatever time frame the movie's for, help you escape reality or elude reality within that time frame of 2 hours, which you already know is predetermined, or i.e. fake. Sounds like something else, side note.
Yeah, but we'll come back to the F word. We'll come back to that.
And so... you have to motivate people. So that's why X actor gets paid millions and millions of dollars, and TV show actors get paid a lot less. Understanding that, come back to combat sports and entertainment, and that's why you might be the best mixed martial artist, you may be the best boxer, you may be the most technical wrestler, but can you put butts in seats is the question.
That's it.
Are you box office, to quote Paul Heyman? That's the part where people don't understand.
That's the thing. And that's why I'm going to bring this circle back to the smart marks. So if there's a smart mark listening to this wanting to know why me and Mustapha are having a conversation right now, it's because we are friends. When you put us in a ring and you put the bell on and there's money on the table, he ain't paying my bills. I'm knocking his ass out.
Exactly. And vice versa.
He's going to try and knock me out.
And that's the game. Because
that's the way it is.
If he doesn't try and beat me and I don't try and beat him, then why are we in this sport for?
That's exactly it. You want to be the best, and that's why you're in the business. Simple as that.
Because people forget. Business. Pro wrestling business. That's boxing, combat sports, entertainment, MMA, wherever you want to pick, business.
It's a business. Somewhere along the line, there's a business transaction which makes it a business.
Yeah.
Now, let's take that business and let's go back to that F word that we all know and hate. The fake word. All right, now growing up as a fan of wrestling and then becoming a wrestler myself, I never got the memo that it was fake. I got the memo it was predetermined,
right?
Which means I know someone's about to kick me in the mouth, and I've got some teeth that are missing that can vouch for that.
I can show it.
Yeah. You can show it, and I've got a few that you know they went bye-bye a few years ago. Fake? No. Predetermined? Yes.
Yes.
But I feel like there's a miseducation about the two.
Yes, fake is, hey everybody, I'm going to punch you in the face. Predetermined is, okay, I have a feeling it's going to lead to this ending. Like any good movie is predetermined. I have a feeling that the good guy is going to prevail in the end. Let's watch and see. Sometimes he does not. What happens then?
That's it. And like, I remember there's a guy back in Ireland. His name is... Justy. Sorry, Justy, I forgot your name there real quick. So Justy Farrell, he said something to me years ago. I'll never forget it. And he said, wrestling is a mix of everything. So you got the drama that will rival most soap operas. You got the action that will rival most Hollywood movies. You got the storytelling that will rival most plays. And you got the theatrics that will rival any other theatrics on the planet, be it circus or theater, anything like that. You also got the athleticism that will rival Cirque du Soleil.
Yep.
And I was actually talking to a former Cirque du Soleil guy about 2 weeks ago who's doing a bit of professional wrestling. You're going to see him coming up soon. Great guy. But he even said that he went from Cirque du Soleil to professional wrestling, and professional wrestling was harder than the Cirque du Soleil. But yeah, I feel professional wrestling doesn't get the respect it deserves from people outside of the field.
I really think if people had a better education to the martial art aspect of professional wrestling, they will understand that there's work behind it. Because professional wrestling doesn't get its due, because you have a certain set of people putting on gear, sites that they can get online.
Yeah.
Get them in one of their friends who is an owner or promoter's ring, and play fight and call themselves a wrestler. So now, the depiction, the dichotomy, the understanding of the art, and professionals or practitioners of this art gets downplayed. Because in MMA, you can put on a MMA gear or boxing, put on boxing gear, until you get cleared by the state athletic commission to partake in that exhibition or combat match or bout. You're not a boxer, you're not an MMA fighter. You're a guy who's training, or you're a guy who's pretending.
Whereas any jabroni can get some gear online, get into his buddy's ring, and be a wrestler.
He can be a wrestler because there's still some places in North America that I know, Kentucky, Ohio, and some other places, Nevada, I think California has brought it back.
Yeah.
Where you have to get a license by the state commission, the athletic state commission.
That's right.
To be a professional wrestler.
That's right. And the coaches got to get licensed to be coaches.
Exactly.
And you have to meet a certain criteria in order to be a coach.
So unless they bring back that format, that will alleviate a lot of nonsense.
Yep.
And show and raise the prestige of all what has been deemed for many years, if not many centuries, as an ignoble sport. Like boxing has been known as a janus sport, a sport of gentlemen or of sportsmanship back in the olden times. It still is today, based on whoever's opinion that you speak to. Now wrestling, based off of Barth, I forgot the gentleman's name. He wrote a whole little anecdote about this. He says in his anecdote, or his observations on wrestling, is that every wrestler has the embodiment of a story.
Mm-hmm.
So depending on how you look, you already have a story before you even get it in the ring. Now, so you, to play off that story and ride the waves of emotions and the waves of belief and suspend disbelief to the people, so people can go, I want more of this. Where can I get more of this?
Yeah.
So a lot of people say, hey, you're a wrestler, you're not that big. Yes, everyone has their role. Not everyone is going to be 6'6", 375 pounds.
That's it. And not everybody needs to be either, because you know you need to have a variety of people getting into the ring on a show. Otherwise, you're watching the same thing over and over again.
100%. So I lost my train of thought, but what I was trying to get to is wrestling. Until we get back to the part where it's you're getting a license,
in most
places, that will fix the image of what a professional wrestler is. Now,
yeah, you gotta be licensed and you gotta be approved, and then everyone knows it's a legit thing.
Exactly. It's not some dude in his backyard or basement calling himself
some butthurt trash bag fucking going ahead and, sorry for the F-bomb, but you know, going in there wrecking himself for no absolute reason.
And now some people's their first experience, their friends or whoever, their neighbors, their first indoctrination to the sport known as professional wrestling is this. So now when you and I invite these people to a show, they already have their predisposed idea of what we're bringing them to. Little that they know, what they saw was complete nonsense. As in complete nonsense, you know, something that they do, but hey, I can't get mad at them if they haven't been trained well. But this can be avoided if there's some form of governing body. That's the word I was looking for. Governing body.
Yeah, you say you can't get mad at them if they haven't been trained well.
Yeah, in the sense that if they if they know that they have no business being there and they do it for the fun, it's like beer league hockey or beer league basketball.
Right.
These
okay.
guys have no business being on a court, on a ring, and on a professional scale.
Right.
Once they acknowledge it's not a professional scale, I don't have a problem with that. But when you parade yourself as a professional and you're far from it, that's where my problem lies.
Now, where do you stand, and I'll give you a prime example, where do you stand on professionals who yeah. are professionals,
yes.
but still do the nonsense? Now, what I mean by that, and I'm going to address the elephant in the room with this one, it is probably going to be an unpopular opinion, but I don't give a fuck. Again, sorry for the F-bomb, but here we go. AEW, we had a Kenny Omega versus Jon Moxley match recently. Have
right.
you seen it?
I watched the highlights of it.
The highlights of it. So I'll break it down for you real quick. This was a hardcore deathmatch style match.
Right.
There was a plank of wood with mouse traps on it that someone got slammed on. There was a sweeping brush with barbed wire that got raked across Moxley's back. There was a bed, like a large bed, wrapped in all this different barbed wire. And there was a suplex off the stage onto it. And then it took 10 guys to get the two boys out of it. And then immediately afterwards, I think Kenny Omega ran and did a flying knee to the face through one of the Perspex AEW signs into the lighting fixture.
Yeah.
Afterwards. You know, I mean, for me personally, I feel like there's no need for that. Those two guys are such a name. They've already paid their dues. You know, you're always paying dues in this business, but they're out there. They already know who they are. They've already made their money. You know, people were going to watch that match no matter what. You know, do you feel like they needed to bring that kind of nonsense to a match?
Honestly, I don't see the point in that. However, what's the payoff?
There you go.
If the payoff is significant, and since AEW's schedule is not the same as their counterparts, WWE in this case, which is the premier company
right.
in the sport, it's not the same schedule. Your payoff is good enough. I don't see why not. But my thing is, you're going to give that off on free TV. Was it free TV or was it the pay-per-view?
I think it was a pay-per-view that you had to
then
see on that.
You need to see what the buy rate was.
That's it.
Because now pay-per-views is how much money you're bringing to the company.
That's
so
it.
So this pay-per-view, we're going away from the pay-per-view format with the networks and streaming and all this. It's kind of a, I don't want to say outdated, but still outdated format. Since New Japan is a streaming service, WWE is a streaming service, and these are the people that you're competing with indirectly and directly.
Yeah.
So let's see what the buy rate was. But if the buy rate wasn't worth the abuse, maybe you should refrain from doing such things unless you know you can draw X amount of buys.
Now, here's another thing, just to stick with this match now real quick, because I watched the pay-per-view. I enjoyed the pay-per-view. I did enjoy the match. Now, I enjoyed the story between Moxley and Omega. It was a great story that was told. I didn't see the point in so much nonsense. You know, so much of the gimmicks that was used in the match. One or two of them would have been fine. They used seven or eight. You know. The part that got me was after the match. You know, you're scrolling through Twitter, you're scrolling through Facebook and Instagram, all the social media, and you're looking at people's comments on the match. And you're looking at general fans who were just watching the show, and you know what the number one comment I seen was? Wasn't enough blood for all the barbed wire that was used. That was what the fans were looking for, blood. But they're not thinking that's a man's flesh. That's a man who's getting cut open for the amusement of total strangers. They just want to see his color.
You know what the irony is? Hockey increased the amount of fights because people want to see blood.
That's it.
When there's a penalty, they want to see people fight and someone bleeds. So I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this goes back to the gladiator times. You know,
yeah.
You know, most arenas is built like a...
Like a gladiator arena, yeah.
A coliseum, right?
Yeah.
You got the entertainers in the middle. Are you not entertained?
Yeah.
So...
What's the problem? We love you.
You know, so I guess there's a bit of bloodlust that lingers in a lot of these fans.
I believe it was Friedrich Nietzsche. I could be wrong, but I think it was Friedrich Nietzsche who said that hurting other people is the one thing that human beings have been consistently good at.
Yeah.
It's the one thing we've been consistently good at is hurting other people. which I find to be nonsense, and that's a total different story for a different day. We won't diverge off of this wrestling path that we're on. Now, sticking with AEW, all right, I want to get your opinion on something.
Yeah.
So, as a wrestler, as a wrestling fan,
yeah,
okay, people are going on and on and on about this ratings war between AEW and WWE.
Yeah.
Now, I've got my opinions on this. My opinion on it, I'll share my opinion before you share yours, just in case you want to change yours in your brain before I say,
no problem,
before you talk. I doubt you will, but we'll go with it. So my opinion is, everyone's saying, oh, AEW is killing WWE in the ratings, right? I believe this to be complete nonsense. Now, if we look at it, AEW is going head-to-head with NXT.
Right.
Now, in the last ratings that I seen for last week, I believe AEW beat NXT by something like, I think it was like 50,000, okay? Which, in rating views, is not a lot. Sounds like a lot, it's not a lot. I think it was like 750,000 to 800,000, give or take a couple of thousand.
Right.
But they were killing them a few weeks before that, and then this, like, because of this whole NXT taking over Raw and SmackDown deal, the fans started chewing in more to NXT, and the ratings went up. Now, what people tend to forget is, if you're going to say AEW is killing WWE, they're not. Because WWE is pumping out three shows a week.
Right.
They're doing Raw, SmackDown, and NXT.
Right.
Raw and SmackDown, respectively, pulled in, give or take, 2.5 million views.
Right.
And then NXT pulled in 750,000.
Right.
So you're talking easily 6 million views.
Right.
Right there, give or take. AEW pulled in 800,000.
Right.
So they're not killing WWE with the views.
They're not killing them, but also you need to take into consideration market saturation, right? WWE has been around for a lot longer.
Yeah.
Even AEW, 3 to 5 years. If they're not breaking the benchmark of 1 million views, then they're not killing WWE.
No.
Give them enough time to grow. My only thing with AEW is that after the guys who have names are gone, what happens then?
That's it.
Because
is there a turnaround? Are they going to keep, you know, for the lack of a better description, are they going to keep hiring indie darlings? You know, to get them on, to keep getting the smart marks to keep watching? Because that's, I don't want to say, I hate the term smart marks, but it is like that demographic of
the 18 to 30 year olds. I like to call them the hardcore fans.
The hardcore fans, there you go. The 18 to 30 year old males, you know, the guys who grew up in the Attitude Era, and that's what they want back. The guys who hate this whole PG era, they want the Attitude Era back. They're the guys that are switching over to AEW because they're getting the sense of that,
yeah,
but they're getting the super indie style wrestling as well.
Yeah, but you know, they need to also understand that those guys, okay, it's cool, but they need to target a younger demographic. Because WWE didn't go out of business versus WCWY. Their target market was kids.
Yeah,
the Attitude Era came, but for the longest while, their target market was kids, because these kids grew up into the Attitude Era, and then they switched.
That's it. So they advertised to grown men and kids in the Attitude Era, because I remember growing up watching it in the Attitude Era, and before every episode, it would say, kids, don't do this at school or home or,
yeah,
you know, on the streets or whatever. So they were giving the warning to the kids not to do it, but not telling them not to watch it.
That's,
you know,
that's,
so the kids were watching it and the adults were watching it. Then the adults stopped, but the kids kept growing up with it.
Okay, that's what caused NWA when it became WCW to fall.
That's it.
They target blue collar working class people.
Mm.
Cool, but when these people age and no longer watch your product, the people who are kind of behind them, you're not catering to them. You're completely not focusing on them.
That's
so the
it.
Kids who became the adults went to the Attitude Era, whatever the other product was, and then they follow suit with that, and then you start to lose interest in your product.
Exactly. And that's where I feel WWE is kind of ahead of the curve now with the new network.
Right.
Because now, for example, whenever I have kids, hopefully someday soon, but one day when I have kids, you know, I'm going to be able to, like, hopefully get them invested in professional wrestling. Hopefully they'll be a fan of it. And if they are, I'll be able to say, well, this is what it was like when I watched it, you know? This is what it was like back in the 80s and the 70s. And then with the network, if it's still going at that time, which it most likely will be, they'll be able to go back and watch the stuff from back then.
Right.
You know? And then they'll understand the progression of what wrestling was and how it went to where it is now, or in the time when they're watching it. Whereas I feel like with the likes of AEW, they don't have that yet. Doesn't mean they won't have it later, but they won't have it yet, which means that it'll be harder for them to get it.
Right. Like they like there's good that they're talking on market that WWE isn't focusing on now, but long term, is it sustainable? Because we saw what happened with WCW.
That's it. But can AEW learn from WCW's mistakes?
That's the question. I think that they will.
Yeah.
As long as they're not overspending and underproducing. You want to be overproducing and underspending, because when that influx of money from sponsors or whoever comes in, now you can start competing. Hey, I'm competing with Raw or SmackDown, and I have another show that competes with NXT.
Yeah.
Then it's a fair. Then I won't say fair, but there will be another understandable battle, because NXT is the development guys mixed with guys on the indies. The guys are the indies are the guys who are mainly on the show that you see weekly. The guys who are in development are in between, or depending on their progression, make their way onto the show.
Yeah.
And if you take those indie guys, or what they call indie guys, mainly ROH, a lot of them are ROH and New Japan guys.
That's it.
You take them out of there, you have a depleted lineup.
That's it.
AEW, you have X whatever company guys mixed with guys who you never heard of.
Yeah.
But my thing with AEW is a lot of their weekly shows. You can't really differentiate their weekly shows from a pay-per-view.
That's it.
I've noticed. So, what is the payoff of me buying a pay-per-view if you're going to give me
the same thing that was on the show?
The same thing on the show. And that's what WCW burned themselves, in my opinion.
Right.
WCW gave you pay-per-view worthy matches on Nitro or Thunder or whatever show that they have, and it always ended in a run-in.
Yeah.
That burned the fans.
Same way, and they never pay-per-view, then they seen the same shit over and over again.
And then they never got the payoff in the pay-per-view. Mm. They never got what they paid for. Like, you tell me Sting versus Scott Hall. That's a pay-per-view main event. Randy Savage versus DDP. That's a pay-per-view main event.
There you go.
And it will end in some kind of smallish finish. And it leads you to wonder, well, what was the point in all this?
Yeah. I totally agree with that. Okay, now we're gonna get wrapping this up soon, because we've been doing this for a little bit and we're almost at our final destination, because we're still on the road. I do apologize if you can hear the motor of the car or anything in the background, but this is a limited edition podcast with the one Mustapha Jordan Richardson, again one half of the Canadian Tag Team Champions and Nitro and Express. Sure. Now we're gonna do a part that I like to call straight shooting. Now, I'm going to fire some questions at you. You give me your first answer, okay? All right. Your favorite movie?
Blazing Saddles.
Oh, wow. Great movie.
Oh, my goodness.
Dude, great movie. Great choice. Wow, I wasn't expecting that.
That's a classic.
Okay, it's a classic. All right. Favorite food?
It's a West Indian dish. Roti.
Oh, okay. All right. I like it. All right. Most embarrassing song in your playlist?
Okay. It's Sweet Dreams by LaBouche.
Oh, okay. All right. I like that. All right, we're going to finish this the straight shooting section off with one last question. If you were to have a Mount Rushmore for wrestling, who would be on your Mount Rushmore?
All right. Harley Race.
Okay.
Flair.
Yep.
Taker.
Yep. You got one more.
Booker T.
Oh, nice choices. Harley Race, Ric Flair, The Undertaker, and Booker T.
Yeah.
That's a Hall of Fame Mount Rushmore right there. I love that.
Yeah, from each guy for various levels of effect that they've played on the sport. Like, I can get into detail for everyone, but that will be another show.
That'll be another podcast. We get Mustapha Jordan Richardson on again. We'll do another podcast at another time. Now, thank you very much, everybody, for tuning in. This has been the High Stakes Podcast with your host, Adam Ace. Make sure to click the subscribe button. We'll be with you again next week. Stay tuned. I'll see you all again soon. Mustapha, thank you very much for being here.
It's been a pleasure to be a part of this, and thank you for having me.
Thank you very much, sir.